proclaim
death to our enemies!
Death to our enemies!
White nationalism in our
Weißer Nationalismus ist jetzt Mainstream geworden, ob es passt oder nicht. Wir brauchen das.
There are very few African American men in this country who haven't had the experience of being followed when they were shopping in a department store. That includes me.
Within his body language said, kill me, I want to be dead. I began to yell, but he's licensed to carry. After that, he began to take off shots.
There's a set of FBI data that suggests that if you are white and you kill a black person, you are more likely to be deemed having engaged in the justifiable use of deadly force. And if you're a black, particularly if you're killing a white person, you're less likely to be seen as justified. It has always been the case that the way we apply the law in this country, we clearly value white life more than we do black life.
Hands up! Don't shoot! Hands up! Don't shoot! Hands up! Don't shoot!
Don't shoot!
Hands up!
Don't shoot!
Hands up!
Good morning. Good morning. There we are. We got to all wake up this morning. This is a topic that could be on center stage of the Congress Center in prime time. And here we are. And look, all of you came out early in the morning. This is an important statement about how important this topic is. The race against racism. Jim Wallis is my name. I'm from Sojourners in the U.S., which is a magazine and a movement. Our mission statement is to put faith into action for justice. That's what we do. We've been in the middle of all these issues back home. We have a wonderful panel. I've just been talking with them in the back room. I'm going to just say who we have here today, then frame the issue a little bit, and then we're going to turn to our panel and see how, from a global perspective, issues of racism, immigration, refugees are all deeply tied together, all around the world. So for our discussion, we have Mr. Abdullahi Alim from Australia. He's a global shaper. And I love his title, Head of Practice for the Lighthouse Strategy. That means you have to practice the things you say you believe. I like that title. Mrs. Yasmina Filali. She is from Morocco, president, founder of the Fondation Orient Occident in Morocco. She's had a lot of experience in Morocco and in Europe. We're looking forward to that. Mr. William Lacy Swing, I've learned he's been an ambassador all over the world. He's been in South Africa often. He's got stories to tell. We have Simone Bowl, who's from Cluster Davos. She's our local girl on the topic. She knows what's happening here with asylum and refugees. Then Maina Kiai, who has joined us, and he is a lawyer from Kenya, and he just traveled to the U.S. and saw all this racism there. And so I always like it when lawyers from Africa travel to the U.S. and see what's going on. So we're grateful for all of you. I'll say more about them when we get to their contributions. I'm not sure if those who planned this panel on this day were aware of the irony of the timing. In my country, today, we have the inauguration of a new president of the United States. In this election campaign, racial bigotry was a constant focus of the election discussion, as was the demonizing of immigrants, as was the fear lifted of refugees, and the call for the banning of all Muslims coming to the U.S. The way I put it is, the racism that is always at least implicit in U.S. politics became explicit. What was often covert became very overt. And I want to tell you that many people in the U.S. this morning are very afraid. People who were targeted directly by the candidate who is now going to be our president. People who already have experienced incidents on the ground in their neighborhoods. Young Hispanic children, African American children, black parents, black pastors are very fearful. As one has said to me, the pastor of Ebenezer Church in Atlanta, Georgia, where Dr. King went, it's going to be open season on my young people now, he said to me last week. There's a great fear. I want to say more as we go on about how the faith community is now mobilizing to protect vulnerable people in the U.S. But there was a session, again, in a tent yesterday on immigration and refugees. And Tim Dixon, who I think is here today, saw somewhere, there he is. Tim's done research on this for purpose. And I love the way you put it yesterday. These are not unrelated policy issues. They're not just different issues. In fact, they're all about what you call, Tim, otherness. Otherness. How we treat people who we think are other than, different from us. So at a deep level, this isn't just a series of policy questions that we can analyze and debate. It's about how we deal with otherness, which now is an issue in the U.S., always been, but all around the world. In Europe, it's become very, very powerful. So how do we address this as people who care about how we treat the other? As I would say, in all of our traditions, it literally is a test of faith. How do we move from us and them to who we want to be? What kind of people, what kind of nations do we want to be? And I want to go to the title here of my young friend, Head of Practice. I don't want to just analyze the issues today, but how we practice different behaviors and different policies to change otherness from asking, what do we want to be? Who do we want to be as a people? So I'm going to start with you, Head of Practice from Lighthouse Strategy in Australia, Abdullahi Alim. You told me you're 24 years old today. Well, this is a great youth perspective. How do you see this in Australia, but now as you see around the world? And you were the one who told me today, this should have been at the Congress Center, prime time. Tell us why.
So I think this subject is very important, and I think the past year has given additional light to that, but it's always been the case. And I think if you look at a comparative analysis between the U.S. and Australia, the U.S. has, so this is in very simplified terms, the U.S. has low levels of high-level racism, the kind of videos that we've just seen, the footage that we were just showing. In Australia, it's quite different. We have high levels of low-level racism. So the kind that's passive, it's coded language, it's wrapped in different institutional discourse, but it's certainly there, and it's equally punishing to those who come from racially minority communities. I think this conversation is important because I work at an innovation lab, and the priorities that I have is to ensure that we maximize the talent that is dispersed and I guess equally spread in our communities. But the truth of the matter is that in this world, talent is universal, while opportunity is not. And to that latter point of opportunity having, being afforded more to certain communities over others, is certainly something that I see, particularly when we talk about race. Racism is certainly real, it's certainly visible, and it's a lived experience for many people like myself. And I think that it takes so much away, not only from our communities, but also just from the broader perspective of nations, from the world at large. And I think it's definitely something that we have to A, acknowledge, and B, address.
So you're saying it is systemic?
Yeah, absolutely.
It is systemic, and it can be implicit or explicit. Mm. Individual or structural?
Absolutely.
Or both? Okay. Now, William Lacy Swing, you have a lot of experience in these questions, so let's move from the global shaper to the elder ambassador. You've been all over the world. Tell us about your experience and how you see this issue. How do we win the race against racism?
Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator. Thank you all. I thought you could hear me. Good morning again. No, I'd like perhaps to be very parochial and talk about what I do today, which is migration, because migration is a real aspect of the race against racism. I think the easiest way to describe it quickly for you and give you an image is that we are in the middle of a perfect storm. What do I mean by that? There are more people on the move than at any other time in recorded history, about 1 billion. Quarter of a billion crossing borders, 750 million moving in their own country. China alone has more migrants internally than the rest of the world has migrants coming to them. If you put them all together, of the international migrants, 250 million, they would be the sixth largest country in the world, slightly smaller than Indonesia's population, slightly larger than that of Brazil. On the other hand, of that number, you have the largest number of people forced to migrate since the Second World War, about 65 million, 23 million refugees, and about 42 million internally displaced persons from conflicts around the world. We have 8 armed conflicts going on simultaneously, complex and protracted, and I see nothing out there right now that can give me any hope of a short to medium term solution. We start with Boko Haram, Nigeria, Lake Chad, Libya, Yemen, Central African Republic, South Sudan, Somalia, half century, Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, and I probably missed one or two. There is violation of international human law on all sides. There is a serious erosion of international moral authority. There is a lack of political courage and leadership on the issue of human mobility and migration. And like Archbishop Tutu, we were talking about him earlier, it's hard to be optimistic on that, but we have to remain prisoners of hope that we can come out of that. And all of that is packaged into attitudes toward migrants, the stereotypes, they're coming to take our jobs, they're probably bringing in disease, they're probably criminals, and now they've added terrorism to it also. And these are people, the cruel irony is, they're fleeing terrorism and being accused and suspected of terrorism. So that is the scene I would set for you, Mr. Moderator, in terms of what we're dealing with.
There was a session this week, a reception about the White Helmets in Syria. You must have heard of the White Helmets, a powerful example of how to respond to conflict. And Neil Kenny Geyer of Mercy Corps said something I didn't know. He said that 10 years ago, 80% of the migration or the movement around the world was caused by natural disaster, 20% by other things. Now 80% is caused by conflict. In 10 years, 80% of the migration around the world caused now by conflict, which is what you're saying there. Now,
Yasmina,
we're getting this right. Americans are terrible, by the way. Yasmina Filali, Morocco. We hear a lot about Morocco in terms of all these issues. So your context shapes so much of what we think and do, where we live, where we're from. So from Morocco, how does all this look to you?
Allow me to
at the very personal level tell you that I am half Moroccan, Italian and French, so I am a mixed identity. This is to tell you that I know before making bridges between communities, I had myself to make bridges, internal bridges, between antagonism. So I know it is difficult, and I know it's a long-term work. In Morocco, we are operating since over 15 years and dealing with migration and refugee issues from mainly sub-Saharan countries. We have more than 2,000 refugees in our centers. And what I want to point out is mainly that the migration problem is politician, is economic, but it's also and mainly cultural. I think that we are here talking about identity, about sometimes wounded, damaged identities, and this is why integration, making bridge between people, is so long and so difficult. So Morocco before was a transit country, and all of a sudden, 6 years ago, Spain made a huge wall and built fences. So they closed mainly the African continent. And we became a hosted country. So we had to really understand how we are going to integrate those people. How are we going to change the image of a migrant from a terrorist, from a vegan, to a man who has dignity? So we mainly made that work between many years, and I have to point out that it was quite difficult, and if we succeed in Morocco, I think we can succeed in many places. Why? Because we are a Muslim Berber country, Arab, and we received black Africans, mainly Christians. So you can understand how difficult was the gap. And we succeeded again by culture, education, culture, education, culture. We have been making interactions, day-to-day interactions with festivals, markets, cooperatives where we mix locals and migrants. The most important thing is, of course, education through school. We have been also making sensibilization to medias. So this is a long-term work, how I was saying, but it's the most powerful one.
You identify culture and identity as key, which I think we need to get back to in this conversation. Back in the U.S., the way fear of losing culture and losing identity has been used politically is very, very frightening to see, and it's going to be at the heart of the inauguration today in Washington. So Maina Kiai, you are a lawyer from Kenya, and you work for the UN. Tell them what you do for the UN. But you went to on a trip to the U.S. in July, was it? And as a reporting trip. And you went to Ferguson, you went to Phoenix, you went to Birmingham, and you reported what you saw, and you reported very directly what you saw, and you got some people saying, whoa, it's really as direct as all that. So I was intrigued by a lawyer from Kenya visiting all of our cities, places of conflict, and your report from that, which I found fascinating. So tell them what your role is and why you went to the U.S., and what you saw and your perspective as a lawyer from Kenya of what you saw in the U.S.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you all for coming to this session. I've done a few sessions here in Davos, and this is really easily the biggest group that we've had, so it's interesting to see there's so much interest in this topic. Now, I am the UN Special Rapporteur on the Rights to Freedom of Peaceful Assembly and Association. So my mission to the U.S. was in the context of protests, looking at protests and how those go on, and then also looking at how people are associating and whether the U.S. government in various levels is respecting people's right to associate, to form associations, to form NGOs, and other things. So I went at a time, of course, when the big protests were the ones around Black Lives Matter. And so as you go around talking and finding out about how the states responded to the protests, you really have to get into the reason for the protests. And one of the things that has emerged within the analysis of protesting in the U.S. has been the militarization of police response. And the police response, especially in Ferguson, in Baltimore, and, and other parts of the U.S. against Black Lives Matter has been incredibly illegal, even by American standards and clearly by international human rights law. Now, what is interesting is that when you look at how U.S. police, how the U.S. police protests in protests that are not by Black Lives, it's much easier. The response by the police is clearly different when it comes to Black people protesting. Let me also make it clear that the U.S. is an interesting place because policing is done at a very localized level, and each city has its own police force. Unlike many of the places which have got a national police, each city in the U.S. has its own police force with its own chain of command and its own habits. So you'll go to a place like Washington, D.C., where the police properly and the police with knowing what to do. Then you'll go to Ferguson, which was interesting because Ferguson is one of, I think, 91 little towns around St. Louis. And there's so many little towns of about 3,000 people, 2,000 people, and they each have a police force. These police forces need to arrest people to be able to pay for themselves. So they fine people, they ticket traffic, little offenses. And all that means then they generally pick up on Blacks. So there's a huge animosity between the Blacks and the police. And that then results in when there's a killing by the police of a Black person, the response is bound to be very angry. But then how the police then responded made things worse. And as we all know, we've followed how the militarization, they come out with tanks, they come out in full body armor. You would think they're at war. You know, they're at war in Syria as opposed to being in the United States of America. So that's the context of what I was doing in the US. And as you go into it, of course, then the issues of race emerge, of racism. And I'm very conscious these days that the idea of race is a product of racism. So what came first was racism, and then we began defining people as racist. It's not that race creates racism. There's nothing phenomenal or interesting about races. It is racism that is the problem. And I think that once you have racism, it then begins defining us in different ways. So what was clear in the U.S. and is clear is that the issue of racism has not been dealt with. I talk to a lot of people who, and in everyday life, at workplaces, at other things, it happens every time. And the person who understands racism is always is the victim of racism. It's very difficult for somebody who's not a victim of racism to explain it and talk about it in a coherent manner. There are many people who I've met as well who, you know, and one of the things that I also talked to the police when I was in the U.S. and many police forces, and they were angry at me and angry at the Black Lives Matter and say, you know, Blue Lives Matter as well. And this whole idea now, in fact, there are now these T-shirts and things going around, Blue Lives Matter, which police color is blue. And others then say, all lives matter. But that is really denigrating the real issue. And the issue is that in the United States today, a Black person is more likely to be killed than any other person by the police. That is a fact, you can't hide away from that fact. It is a fact. So when you start talking about Blue Lives Matter, you're trying to say, you know, you're trying to equate police who are armed, who have the right to defend themselves, their lives, to those who are not armed and those who are being victimized. So it's a very interesting way of reducing, or trying to reduce, if you wish, the impact of a real issue that's going on in the United States. And then I've met people who say, of course, you've seen this, all lives matter. Of course, all lives matter. But in terms of victimization, in terms of survival, in terms of energizing people to stand up, Black Lives Matter is an incredibly strong slogan and incredibly strong approach. And I happened to participate actually when I was there in Philadelphia, in a march by Black Lives Matter in Philadelphia during the Democratic Convention, because I was also going to see how people do their organizing or their associating for political purposes at a Democratic Convention. I also went to the Cleveland one for the Republican Convention. But it was interesting again seeing how that march happens and how brave it is. And I think one of the most fascinating things is how this new movement of people is happening around Black Lives Matter and how that is going to be a new model of organization. I think one of the things that struck me most is that the old forms of associations that we have known, the NAACPs, for example, and other forms of formations, are reaching their sell-by date. And the new forms that are happening, young people are coming out. And it was incredibly great to see in the protests, how many white people also come to the protests. Mm-hmm. And they come out because they care. And I think that's the part you feel hopeful, that it's not that there is an understanding about these things. And I think that when you're dealing with racism, you can't solve racism by the community alone. It needs everybody's inclusion. It needs everybody to understand what it is and everybody to come forward and say, this is part of who we are and where we are going. So in that context, that's been one of the most fascinating parts of the work I've been doing.
So Abdullahi talked about racism as structural, and you saw that in the U.S. Warriors to Guardians is one of the phrases in the president's new commission on policing. And what's behind that, he had a meeting in the Oval Office, Barack Obama, with the leaders of Black Lives Matter. And he came out from that meeting and put forward this new policing commission. And, you know, the fact that many people don't know, the drug war, the U.S. drug war, Brian Stevenson talks about how we've moved from 200,000 people in prison to 2.2 million in about 20 years. And the drug war is the cause of most of that. But white drug use and black drug use is exactly the same in the U.S., exactly the same, no difference at all. But the incarceration is all black and brown. And then, as we talked in the green room back there, when you're incarcerated and you are charged with felonies, even for nonviolent drug crimes, when you come out of prison, you lose your right to vote. Millions of black men and women have lost their right to vote. I would say systematically disenfranchised, and who couldn't vote in this last election. So this is all tied together in all kinds of ways that often it takes a lawyer from Kenya to reveal to things in the U.S. But, you know, it's always all local. And so we have Simone Bowl, who is our local panelist today from Davos Cluster. And you want to speak in German, where you're most comfortable. I told her English is much better than my German, so she shouldn't apologize for that. So put on your headphones if you need it, and we'd like to hear. You're working with asylum and refugees here, right here in the community. So tell us how all this translates down to right here in Davos Cluster.
Yeah, guten Morgen.
Well, first of all, good morning. I work with refugees, ones that have been recognized initially as being refugees coming to Davos. I have to support them financially and find a place for them in our society, take care of their integration. Here, as in the rest of Europe, there is a fear of the other. I think we're increasingly recognizing that there's a fear of that which we don't know. 65 million people are now, as we've heard, refugees. That's equivalent to the size of a country like the UK or France. Many of them are coming to Europe. So there are many lessons to be learned. And the issues that we're dealing here are issues of belonging. And what we have to do is make sure that we can give these people who are arriving a story, a face, so that they can be recognized. I'd like to tell you a story to illustrate this. A young girl came with her mother to Davos 2 years ago. They came to my office. She was very young, under five, and I was very moved by her background and her story. She'd had very traumatic experiences in her early life. In her family, she'd experienced how her father had been killed in front not only of her but the whole family. The family had to run. She and her five siblings embarked with her mother, but they'd been lost on the way, so that at the end of that terrible journey, only the child and her mother were left. Their siblings have since then been found, and two of them have joined this family. What I'm deeply touched by in this story is how happy this girl is, how much confidence and trust she has in life, in her new life in Switzerland. And I look at that and I think, well, I can learn from that. It gives me real hope and confidence when I see that this is possible. There are many stories that are very positive, that much positivity is being brought by refugees who are coming to Switzerland. They're certainly not all terrorists. We can't stop terror. The best secret services in the world cannot stop terrorists who are becoming radicalized alone. It's very difficult to do this, but putting that aside, we see huge positivity coming. We see the possibility for new relationships, new stories, and we can really encourage the curiosity from those of us who are already here to learn what these new arrivals are bringing with them. Another example is somebody who has worked in a hospital with an understanding of relationships. This is somebody who hadn't grown up with all the technology we have now, but the people who are working with this, the new arrivals, said what an incredible lesson they learned from the warmth of their relationship. So we don't need to have fear.
You raised the issue of stories and seeing faces and being changed by the people who are immigrants, refugees. And I'm finding that every place I listen to this conversation, it's what changes us is those, as you say, new relationships. I'd like to put that to the panel in terms of to talk about how to overcome otherness. It really is about these stories that change people. We heard yesterday in Canada, all the people who are volunteering to take refugees in to their homes. And every one of them who told the story on the video, they got very emotional when they began to speak, as you just did, about particular people that they've come to know. And it changes their sense of who these people are and then who you are. So I'd like to raise that question of stories to the panel. How do these stories change us and how have they impacted your work? Anyone respond to what Simone did? Yeah.
Okay.
Maina.
Just, I think it's a great question you've asked about how we can, in a sense, embrace otherness. And I think that's because in every society, no matter how homogeneous it may look like in the racial makeup or even ethnic makeup, there's always bound to be differences somewhere, whether it's clans. And Somalia is a great example of a country which is ethnically homogeneous, it's culturally homogeneous, it's religiously homogeneous, every single part of it. But then it breaks up into little clans and sub-clans and other things, which then causes conflicts. We've seen that in Europe as well, with the wars, First World War, Second World War. People always break up into small things. So the question as well for all of us is how to do it. Now, one of the things around this so-called migration issue, when it was at its height in 2015, and for me, looking at it as a non-European, seeing people crossing borders from Syria, from Eritrea, to come into Europe, and the labeling was that they are migrants. And it just, it disturbed me, because the how we name things makes a difference. I consider anybody leaving Eritrea a refugee, because it's a jail. Eritrea is a prison. And so if we start calling people migrants, we start then thinking that they are economic migrants, as though that's something wrong. But refugees should evoke some sympathy. And when people are refugees, then there are also conventions that then mean people have to take care of them. So I think then the way we name things also is important. I want to tell a little story. In the 1990s, I was traveling in Central America, again from Africa, going to Central America. I was there for a few weeks. I was in Guatemala, and you walk around Guatemala, and I was the only black person. Then I see these two guys there who are black. So eventually we make contact, because we are so isolated, and we have a cup of tea together. And it turns out there was one guy from Senegal and one guy from Ghana. And they had begun a journey from Africa, first to Colombia, flying to Colombia, and then driving up their way, up north. And their goal was to get into the U.S. And they said, we're going to go to the U.S. We're in Guatemala now. Mexico is the next stop. When we get to Mexico, we'll work a bit, make some money, and then we'll buy papers to cross the U.S. And I asked them, because they've been doing this for 6 months. And I asked them, but why do you want to go there? They say, look, what we have, there's nothing back home. We're going to do this. And we know it's tough. But what strikes me most, and when you hear the stories of people walking over the Sahara Desert to get to Morocco and Libya to go to Europe, what strikes you is how creative and determined these people are. So yes, they may be economic migrants, but if you're an employer and somebody has dared to walk across Sahara Desert, for crying out loud, employ that person. They are going to be hardworking. I mean, they're not going to be draining your system and your social welfare. These people are determined, and that's for any employer. That's what you want: determination, creativity, fortitude, and that's a good thing. So, in fact, it's Africa's loss when people are crossing the deserts to go into Europe. But I think it's Europe's gain. And rather than seeing them as dangerous, honestly speaking, somebody, and if you see how tough that journey is, and what people have to go through, honestly speaking, I don't understand how people can turn their backs on them. It doesn't make sense, because this is quality. This is quality in every sense of the word. And I think it's something that we have to start looking at when we are looking at all this. And the third thing I want to say is, and this particularly affects Europe, and when I look at it's something that worries me, is that Europeans were the original migrants, going off into the US, going off to Canada, going off into Australia, perhaps by force from the Brits. But when you hear a statistic that a third of the Swedish population migrated to US and Canada in the late 1800s, it is an amazing statistic. It's an amazing statistic, a third of the population. There are more Irish people outside of Ireland by far than there are in Ireland. And you can go through across Europe and talk about how much economic migration was done and happened. And then all of a sudden now people have migrated and say, now we don't want any more. It's enough. You know, it's an interesting phenomenon, because I think it's a real human thing to try and move and want to get a better life for yourself. And I think one of the issues for the next few years in our world is look at how we are forced to, you know, you're born somewhere and you're stuck with that nationality without your choice. We have no choice about which nationality we have. And maybe it's something we need to start looking at, as just the same way we can do, we have rights to do things. But nationality, we expected that because you're born in Belgium, you're going to be a nationalist Belgium, you're going to like Belgium. But why should you? Why should you? Why can't you be a French, you know, or be a Australian? You know, we should have the right to choose our nationalities and not be pegged down there simply by an accident of birth.
I'm always struck by activists who are involved in these issues. They can give you a good analysis of the problem, but what motivates most of us who are involved is stories. Mm. What motivates us, what's changed us, what makes a difference in our lives, stories. And as we all go out from here, I hope we don't go out with, oh, I found that interesting, or I learned these three things. It's more, what's going to motivate us to take action against the kind of racism, the kind of otherness that separates people. It's very, you just said, it's very human to want a better life. And so stories, other, I saw when I said stories, some of you perked up other stories that you'd like to share that motivate you in this work.
In the space of storytelling, while it's very important to give space for refugees to speak of their experiences and speak of their narratives, it's also important for us as well to analyze the narratives that we are consuming of and about refugee communities. Mm-hmm. It seems impossible in today's world to talk about refugees without having to talk about national security. It's impossible to speak about migration without speaking about terrorism. We've highly securitized and politicized the experiences mm-hmm. of refugees to the point where they're one and the same. And I think the ultimate insult that you can make as a human being is to lump the perpetrator and the victim as one. And so I think while it's important to showcase the narratives of refugees, it's also very important for us to also analyze the narratives that we are consuming and we are perpetrating.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Yeah.
I think that in Europe mainly, we have lived a bankruptcy and a failure of the first, second, and third generation of migration. The integration didn't work. That is why today we have the reflection of this failure into the migration and refugees issues. So my interest and my meaning now is to understand how politicians will make a vision of what society we want to live in. How are we going to shape that society? As you said, Ambassador, we are going to live a huge and massive arrival of more and more migrants. How are we going to deal with that? How are we going to interfere? And some countries of Europe resist. Austria, maybe France. Some countries did not resist, like United States. So I think that we have to fight for a better world, and we have to ask politicians to give us the vision of it.
Fighting for a vision of what kind of society we want to be. It's a very powerful phrase. And not let others define what that society is. I remember years ago back home when I began to do anti-racism training in America, white people, calling themselves white people. I would always find it interesting how most Americans with European, who are from Europe, have very little ethnic connection anymore with their European ancestry. They don't think of themselves as from Europe. And so I try to get them to do that, and I would finally make jokes. I would say, you know, you Swedes, you're just like the Irish. I can never tell you apart. And they all laugh. Are you Germans and Italians? You're just exactly the same. And they all laugh. I said, you must be the same, because when you came to America, you all became white people. This notion of a white race. We invented that. We created that. There is no white race. There are ethnicities, nationalities, but we all became white people, and our white identity defined us even more than our ethnicities. It's important to look at what race is, and the reason that people say all lives matter, it's to counter what Black Lives Matter is saying, and they're saying all lives won't matter until Black Lives Matter. And actually, blue lives won't be safe until there's community policing and not the militarized policing you saw in Ferguson. So now I see all this conversation in Europe, and it's interesting to me, and I would like to know what you all think about this. It's like almost Europeans who came to America and became white people for the first time. Now it's almost like becoming white people again. Back in Europe, back to a racial identity instead of the ethnicities that you're talking about, and saying what kind of society do we want to be? I find that a very fascinating question. Any thoughts? Yeah.
I had a number of thoughts on this, and I don't want to be too long, but first of all, I think if you're going to deal with racism, you cannot, and you've just made the point, you cannot resolve your fears or the whole question of racism on the basis of identity. We're not going to change the color of our skin. We're not going to change the way we speak. We're not going to change the religion we practice. But we might be able to come together around something more common like values or interests. The IMF has just published a study. If people can't get it any other way, business and others understand that migration and diversity is good for business. So let's argue it on economic grounds. IMF came out with a study in October at the meeting in Lima, Peru, that basically said that countries with migrant-friendly, in other words, diversity-friendly policies, will do better economically in the medium to long term than those who don't. Now, on the European question, I think Europe is, I think, going through a transitional phase, and we're very pro-Europe. All 28 members of the European Union are members of IOM. But they're facing three problems. One is what I referred to earlier, refugee amnesia. We've forgotten. Our organization, IOM, and UNHCR, we were joined at the hip in 1951 for one purpose, to take Europeans, all these different groups you talked about, ravaged by the Second World War, to safe shores and new lives. Last year was the 60th anniversary of the Hungarian Revolution. You remember? 200,000 Hungarians fled to open arms, open hearts, open pocketbooks in Austria and former Yugoslavia. So that's number one. The second problem is the dysfunctionality of the Union on such questions, although the Commission and the Council are really trying hard. But if you have a train going under tracks and the wheels have fallen off some of the wagons, you don't make much progress. And the third one is an interesting one, I think we were talking about. Psychologically, Europe has peopled the world for three centuries. Colonies everywhere, business, and now multinationals, etc. So they were a continent of origin. Today, given the demographic challenge, the demographic deficit in the north, and the demographic surplus in the global south, they become a continent of destination. And that changes everything, because you've been used to sending your people out rather than bringing other people in. I guess the other change is the challenges we face are to change the migration narrative. It's currently toxic. And to do that, we have to come back. We all have to do a better job of storytelling. Let the migrants tell their stories. My country, our country, yours and mine, was built on the backs of migrants with the brains and the talent of migrants, these same people who struggle to get to a place, motivated, eager to work, and wanting to contribute. Right now, we're robbing migrants of their dignity. We're putting them in danger, and we're depriving ourselves of their contribution. So I think this is our issue.
I have a story, because of course we need to talk about emotions. And by the way, a day in the life of a refugee was a very emotional experience here in Davos.
Mm-hmm. How many of you went to that, saw that, experienced that?
Oh, you should.
Okay. Tell them why they should.
You should, because then you will change your mind about what is it to go through terrible things, and what does it mean to be a refugee. And I don't want to tell you more, but please go. My story is about human trafficking that we experienced in Morocco. We worked for 2 years in a forest camp with Médecins Sans Frontières. And we have a transmission point in Morocco for the Nigerian mafia for prostitution. And they take the women from Nigeria, they stock them in the forest. And when I went there to visit the camp, I couldn't believe it, because I saw like 300 women. And all the women were pregnant, 8 months. So I said to the people, but what's going on? And they told me, in order to go to Spain and not to be sent back, they have to be pregnant 8 months. So the gang were reproducing a real terror implementation. You had the chief, you had the major, you have everybody, and you have the dog. And after the dog, you have the women. So I said, but why is the dog so important? They said, because he prevents when the Moroccan policy will arrive. So they closed everything and they hired. And I said to him, I said, but what are they hiding in their country to go through all that experience?
This is, I think I'm the only faith leader on the stage here to make one comment about that. This notion of otherness, how we treat the other, really is a test of faith in most of our traditions, how we treat the other. And back home now, we have this crisis because so many people are afraid. And so next week, we're going to launch a project from the faith community. Matthew 25, the Gospel of Matthew, 25th chapter, is the words of Jesus where you might remember he says, I was hungry, I was thirsty, I was naked, I was sick, I was a stranger, immigrant, I was in prison. And how you treat those people is how you treat me, he says in that text. So we're launching this Matthew 25 pledge and project to protect vulnerable people, and it focuses on three groups in great danger right now after today, after the inauguration. One is undocumented immigrants, people who are undocumented. 11 million people in the U.S., 11 million are undocumented. And President Obama gave these young people, through an executive order, protection. 700,000 turned in their names and now are working as young people, and they're undocumented. Now they're in great danger of being deported, having their families broken up. Second is young people who are in danger from police in their communities, young people of color. And so they're the second group that are most fearful, black pastors, black parents being afraid for their children. Third is Muslims who have been demonized in this election, who've been threatened with banning and registration. And so you've got now people saying to this new government, if you arrest and try and deport these 11 million people, you're going to have to arrest many of them in our churches, in our seminaries, in our home. We're going to take them in and provide sanctuary. You'll have to arrest them in our homes and churches. Two, to the police question, clergy will be going to local police and saying, we want to help you with community policing, not the militarized kind, but if you do racialize policing, as you saw in all those cities, we will hold you accountable as clergy. We'll watch you, we'll film you, we'll record you, and we'll hold you accountable. And if they, with Muslims, if they indeed call for registration, which is frighteningly possible of Muslims in America, you'll have priests, pastors, and rabbis being the first in line in those registration lines. So this is a policy of resistance against what could happen to those people. So you'll hear about that next week, this taking a text, gospel text, Matthew 25 pledge and project to protect those who are vulnerable. And then what happens is when we begin to get close to people who are vulnerable, they change us, as you've heard. Their stories change us and how we think, and that motivates us to go further. I think we are ready to open this up. 5 more minutes, okay. When we talk about these huge policy issues, migration, immigration, refugees, and underneath there's this, I would say, almost spiritual question of otherness and who the others are. You all on the panel, you're all actors, you're activists, you are working on these issues. What is it that you, when people in this kind of an audience, when they listen to what you're saying, what is it that you most want them, hope that they begin to do? Or say, how do you want people to act to hear this kind of conversation? Let's just go down the aisle. What are you hoping for? Why do you come and speak to me? What do you hope to see them do?
Sensibilize, to testimony, seeing what they are passing through. We are a voice, maybe to be a voice and let you decide whether you want to interact, if you want to understand, if you want to resist also. Maybe we'll have an appointment later on. Just listen.
Mm-hmm. I think the more you can help migrants to have access to tell their own story. We have a campaign now called I Am a Migrant. We've recorded probably at least 500 migrants recorded their story. You can go to our website and see these, at the contribution they're making, how they feel about it. Secondly, the way you vote is very important, because politicians, rather than helping people to deal with their fears about the other, are actually exploiting those fears to be elected and reelected. And migration is not something that gets you elected these days, and it should, because migration contributes to your society. Those are two things you can do, and try to help us to change the public narrative, and try to help us, if you can, to learn to embrace diversity. It's good for us.
Abdullahi.
I would say give a listening ear. If somebody is telling you their experiences, let them live in that experience. Do not delegitimize their truth and the narratives and the experiences that they have. I also want to say that it's also very important that we have open and public discussions about these issues. There is a difference between race and racism. It's okay to speak about race and the subjects that come around that. If it becomes this taboo subject, it goes underground. And any time a subject goes underground, it usually manifests and comes back to the surface in a much uglier form. So it's okay, and if you want to have public discussions, it's very, very easy to do so in today's tech-savvy world.
Mm-hmm.
Simone. Well, I'd like to quote Nelson Mandela, who said something like, "Nobody is born to hate. Hate is something that we have to learn as humans." So I think it's important to give people a chance, recognize that everybody has human rights, inalienable human rights. You don't have to earn those human rights. They are ours. Changing our perspective can come from having an open ear for migrants, listening to them, and I believe that in that way we can change the future.
Maina?
I think for me, there are two things. One is that you just put yourself in the other person's, in the other's shoes. That really is one of the most important things we can do. And the second thing is the fact that, and I think just would like us all to leave with the fact that even though we are talking now today about Europe, maybe a bit of Australia and the United States, this otherness issue and this phobia, if you wish, against migrants and others is a global trend. It's not just in Europe and Australia. Where I'm from in Kenya, we have a real phobia with Somalis, who, as African as we are, when the Somali people run away from Somalia, we put them in camps, and the largest refugee camp in the world is in Kenya. And it's something that's very un-African. And it's interesting to hear you, sir, about how religious leaders are coming together, because where I'm from, the Christian leaders have absolutely nothing to do with the refugees who are Somali or from South Sudan, and they are part of the problem as opposed to being part of the solution. So and we know, of course, what's going on in Burma with the Rohingyas and the Burmese majority. So it's across the world. And I think the thing we need to figure out is, why is it that we as human beings have this intolerance against those who may look different, may worship differently, may have different views? And this whole idea of fundamentalists. It's okay to disagree, it's okay to be different, but do I have to finish you off because you're different?
My comment would be responding to Abdullahi, the difference in race and racism, very important. I call racism America's original sin. Original sin, because we just didn't do slavery that had been done before. We said it was the Christians, speaking of how faith can be on the wrong side, Christians who said, you can't do what we are doing to indigenous people, taking their land and their lives, and kidnapped Africans, making them into chattel property. You can't do that to people who are made in the image of God. Genesis chapter 1. So we have to say they weren't really made in the image of God. They're not fully human. We have to throw away this notion of image of God, imago Dei. We threw away imago Dei in our slavery to make people less than human. And if you think that's an old idea, out on the street in Ferguson one night with a 16-year-old kid during the protests, he said to me, you know, I still feel like I'm treated like three-fifths of a person, which is what the U.S. wrote in the Constitution, that blacks were three-fifths of a person. So this notion of how slavery continues, the original sin lingers on because it's the dehumanizing of the other. The other is not really made in the image of God. That's what makes us all one. We are all made in the image of God. And for me, from a faith point of view, that's foundational to overcoming the otherness. But our continuing original sin goes on, and it was fanned, the fears were fanned by this election. And now we're going to see what happens in the governance from the campaigning. And so the faith community is wanting to protect vulnerable people because that's what always changes us and reminds us of, in fact, how we're made. Now it is time to open it up. Do we have microphones or? Yes. We do. Okay. I see a microphone right next to an open hand. Then I want to come up to Tim Dixon here in front in a few moments. But go ahead.
I'll ask my question in German. My name is Alec Gagne, and I welcome what Mr. Swing has said, that we need to embrace diversity. The greatest diversity that is being destroyed is the fact that we are losing so many types of plant and animal. Warren Buffett said that there is a war of the rich against the poor. We, the rich, are winning this war. If you like, this is a kind of racism that is taking place at the moment, the racism of rich against poor. I also think there's a racism against compassion. If people die in France or Germany from bomb attacks, then Google suddenly changes its homepage to the flags of Germany or France. If that happens in Libya or in Iraq, that doesn't happen. Our monuments don't have, don't pay tribute to people lost in illegal wars. We need to underline that immigration can take place voluntarily. Many people are coming from war zones, and those who sell weapons sow the seeds of refugees. Now, some people might say this is good business. And the weapon business is one which increases GDP. Everybody seems to be worried about the GDP, but I don't believe that it's genuinely linked to quality of life. And finally, I think that we should stand together. If we are diverse in our religion, in the color of our skin, then we can recognize that, but we should not be divided by it. The most important thing is to say no to the export of weapons and closing NATO bases throughout the whole world. Thank you.
Could you bring the microphone up here? I want Tim Dixon, who's done research on immigration in Europe, fascinating things right here in front, to share a bit of that briefly. And then I want you to ask questions of panelists about what we are seeing and how to change it, very specifically. So, Tim.
Thanks, Tim. So I'm very interested in thoughts from the panel just on I mean, I think the we've been doing quite a lot of research. We've got reports coming out, Germany and France, that are really digging into what's driving the appeal of populism. And I do think that from what's unusual about this moment is the political dynamics are really similar across the West, and it's quite remarkable. And it's the issue of otherness that's working everywhere. I think what the research points to for us is that, you know, we're in something of a race against time, not just a race against racism. It's not because whole countries are embracing racism, but it's because, you know, maybe a quarter of the population responds to directly to the populist xenophobic appeal. There's another group, 25-35%, pretty consistently across different countries, who've got more cosmopolitan values. They're highly educated, city dwelling, more affluent. They're us, right? And then there's a group in the middle, 40-50%, who have a set of anxieties about, I think fundamentally, immense economic insecurity and so forth, but it's a loss of belonging and a loss of identity. And the populists are coming along and saying, here's the answer. Define us and them. The threat is them. We have to define ourselves. We can make ourselves great again. America, Germany, France, whatever. We make ourselves great again by drawing these lines. The challenge, I think, for us is that the conversation that we have as the mostly belonging to the sort of cosmopolitan, liberal, you know, citizens of the world identity, we don't actually relate to the more localised identity. Our way of seeing the world doesn't work for that group in the middle, the anxious middle, the 40 or 50%. They're being persuaded that the problems that they're seeing around them, the loss of identity, is actually to do with immigration, and it's a threat to culture and to security and to their economy. So I think the question for us is, how do we reach the middle, which is a different question for us than how do we persuade ourselves? And so much of the way that we're talking about the issue, you know, makes more sense, doesn't really reach much beyond that 25-35% of the population. So I think the pragmatic question for us to ask is, you know, where do we learn from each other about how we shift the dynamics of rising racism and the rising appeal of racism, not just at the individual level, but across whole countries? What lessons can we draw from past history where that rising tide of racism, which, you know, is a fundamental threat to democracy, where do we learn the lessons? And I think one key insight that we get from our research is that it's not the appeal of the message of diversity is great and difference is great, which actually terrifies an awful lot of people in the middle who aren't racist, but they're just scared of change, but a message more around inclusive patriotism that says, you know, this is what being French is. It's being an inclusive society. This is what being American is. It's being an inclusive. It's being a melting pot. And building those narratives that are local but are also inclusive. Mm-hmm. I'd be interested in thoughts on that, because I think that's what the research across different countries, that seems to be the most powerful message, that has a sense of belonging and identity and answers the need that people have, mm-hmm. and their sense of dislocation, but does it in a way that includes the other and doesn't define identity as being all about exclusion. And I think that then says we need faith groups, we need sports, we need mainstream culture, you know, we need... And politicians aren't the ones who make that happen, right? It's a bigger fight, mm-hmm. around culture.
Thoughts on that, quickly. Thoughts on that. Yeah, quick. Jump in. Go ahead. Please.
Okay. I think that's very useful and very... It's very important. Just in terms of what might work, perhaps in terms of lessons, is looking at how the LGBTI community has managed to mainstream itself across most of the Western world in a matter of years. I mean, it's in a matter of in the last 20 years in very many ways, where 10 years ago, if you talked about gay marriage as an issue, almost everybody in the West would say we don't want it. It's not a good thing. But there's been cultural change, I think, on that aspect where people say it's fine. I think there's a lot to... And from my perspective, I think one of the most important changes has been in Latin America, which is a vastly Catholic community. In 1999, at the UN, the leaders of the homophobe community were Latin countries, Islamic countries, African countries, Asian countries. Today, the leaders of the openness debate at the UN level of human rights is Uruguay, it's Argentina, it's these countries from Latin America. How that change happened, I still don't understand, but I think it did happen over 15 years that there's been a real transformational change. The US, the same thing. If you look at how the voting at the polls around gay marriage, just five years ago, it was way 60% against gay marriage. Today, I think polls are saying it's 60% supporting gay marriage. That's a huge culture shift, I think.
So I'm hearing from the research in that it's supporting cultural change, not just political change. Yeah. Abdullahi.
Yep. So I think the work that you're doing is fantastic from a research perspective, but I also think it's important also to look at the work of practitioners. The organization that I'm involved with, we do a lot of work in the space of combating hate speech and combating extremism. And in that space, we do work with a lot of former right-wing extremists and a lot of former neo-Nazis. Mm-hmm. And it's important to look at their narratives. Their experiences are often highly demonized as well. And the same common thread comes through when you ask, why did you choose this life? Mm-hmm. Why did you resort to a life of this form? And the common answer is, I didn't have an alternative. I was never given an alternative. So if you look at the past year and a bit, and looking at the rise of populism, it comes down to four main categories. It's A, the major terrorist attacks, it's a migration crisis, it's a disillusionment with the establishment, and it's a stagnant economic system. And unless you're able to communicate the why and provide an alternative to those communities, you have to realize that you are actually fighting for those basically pools of people with populist candidates, with violent extremist organizations, and unless you can communicate in a way that's savvy and makes meaning to them, you're going to just see more and more of this.
We're just talking to ourselves over and over again. Questions? We have a microphone. Where's the mic? Okay.
Ms. Filali, at the beginning of the discussion, talked about or touched upon the idea of building bridges between minorities and people that have different backgrounds and different stories. And I was wondering, which are the steps that you think are necessary in order to actually build those bridges?
How do you build bridges? Good. I love short, succinct questions, not sermons and commentaries. How do you build bridges?
Please. Short answers, too.
Yes, I love short answers, too.
Okay, so you were right saying that it is very difficult to go to the other because we feel so secure in our own community. And we don't have to be naive. To go to the other is a very important human being movement. It's kind of a journey. And I really do think that you have to be supported to do that movement. If you're not prepared, it's impossible. So we have been building a wide range of intercultural activities, building, having festivals where you can have people meeting through music, through sports. Mm-hmm. If you have people building a project together, then they will see the future in the same way and they can make a movement in mm-hmm. in the same time.
Exactly. I see a hand right back there. Yes, right there, and then back up here. Please.
Good morning, esteemed panelists. I have been really kind of anxious to get to the mic, not to be heard, but to start something here. My name is Gail Davis. I'm Listen, Give Initiative, and I'm in a United Nations external partner around the Sustainable Development Goals. It starts with each one of us in the home. It starts with how we train our children. But I'm going to leave off with this. President Obama said in his speech recently, when Irish first came to the United States, they were seen as an issue. When the Italians came to the United States, they were seen as an issue. When the Chinese came to the U.S., and thereon, they were seen as an issue. But quickly, they became part of the infrastructure that together built the United States, that all of us together built countries. We must look inside of ourselves, because at the end of the day, if you prick us, we all bleed red. And I think if we can come from that place of celebrating one another and celebrating culture, okay, and the belief structure of each person and get down to the human, the very basic human form and needs, that's where we begin. The research is great and all of that is great, but practicality and applying this practicality of just basic human to human needs. We all put our pants on the same and we go to sleep the same at night. Thank you.
So the audience of our children who watch what we say and what we do may be our most important audience. Yeah. Right here? Right here? Then back here. Two close here.
My name is Olav Fiksetveit. I'm the General Secretary of the World Council of Churches, and I'm very keen to listen to your many aspects on these issues. Let me formulate my interest in a question. We hear a very interesting example how religious leaders and actually religion is part of the problem, not only in Europe or in America, but also in Africa. And the question is then, how can we together, and I have to speak in a self-critical way on my part, make the religious leaders and the religious communities really a source of solving the problem? I think there are many indications of what you have said, but I could like to hear more, both how you hear how we are a problem, but also how can we become part of the solution.
Part of the problem, part of the solution. Comments, and then we'll go here. On that. I'm a faith leader, so I should probably say something. It's the difference in thumping your Bible or reading it. The Bible is very clear on how we treat the stranger, and Jesus is really a test of our faith. So it's I would say in the last election, white Christians were more white than Christian. So finally, it's a matter of what comes first. What comes first? And if we actually talk about what our traditions say about this, this how we treat the stranger is as central in our scriptures as anything is, how we treat the stranger, the other. So that's the foundation for in all our traditions, Jewish, Muslim, Christian. So getting back to the tradition and how our cultures have captivated us, or we've been conformed to our cultures, and not the tradition. So it's almost getting back to what we say we believe. You want to comment on that?
Yes, I do, because I come from a very religious country, and we like to say that we are a Christian nation. But I think the Christianity is very thin, and after 6 years of boarding school, in a Christian boarding school, I have very strong views about Christianity, which I don't want to say. But I think the bigger part of it is the question you ask, what can we do? Is I think the in the context of where I'm from in Kenya, the church is a highly politicized organ. Mm-hmm. The church pretends to be Christian. The church needs to because it's intolerant. I mean, it's whether it is gay rights. You're seeing the African church is moving out of all the structures because they're having more and more tolerance. There's a huge problem with the African church and understanding what Christianity is. What is the solution? I think we've got to find more African Christians who will be in the lime. I think Archbishop Tutu, who you mentioned, is for us the epitome of an African Christian. He's tolerant, he's up there. There's no one following in his footsteps. I don't see any African Christian leader out there. But for us, again, in Kenya, is that the Christian movement has been seeing Islam as the problem. And they say it in the churches, they don't say it publicly, but that's how they define the problem. The Islam is growing, you've got to stop it. And so they stop it. To stop it, they become more and more intolerant and more fundamentalist.
Immigration has been one of the key issues Francis has focused on in the Vatican. Here's a question here.
Anita Fani.
Then two over there.
The term damaged identity was used earlier. I'd like to know how you see the difference between damaged identity and loss of identity, and if there's a way that one can heal the identity or repair it.
Mm-hmm. Good question. Who'd like to speak to that? Please. Simone.
Ich denke,
Well, that's a difficult question, I think. A lost identity is nothing. If I've lost my identity, I have to find myself again completely. A damaged identity is difficult to heal. I think the way to heal it is to give people their dignity back, and through dignity they can recover their identity. And work can be part of that. Being part of a society can definitely be part of that.
Your thoughts? Identity?
Well, a damaged identity is an identity that has not been valorized and that has been pointed out from the entire society, that have been isolated, humiliated. So this is mainly what a big part of the first, second, third, and fourth generation of North African in Europe will feel.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to get to a few more questions here. Microphone over here. Yeah.
I'm Thomas Forer from Switzerland, and I think what we missed is what you said before, what makes the relation? I think it's a question of number. In Switzerland, we have 20% foreigners, and they're getting more. And everybody says, oh, foreigners. In the US, you are losing the white majority pretty soon. What are you doing with that? That's a question.
Well, I was wondering whether to raise that, but now I will. The most important political fact about the United States that's underneath everything, underneath this election result, everything, is by 2040, we'll no longer be a white majority nation for the first time. We'll be a majority of minorities. And older white Americans are having a hard time navigating that, what I call it, the bridge to a new America. So that's underneath everything. Our changing demographics are challenging all the old identities. But younger people really are embracing and often expecting. My kids now, their assumption, their expectation is diversity. That's their life experience. But this is the battle, and it was underneath this election. This election is because of a white backlash to that reality. By 2040, we're no longer a white mature nation. So that's going to be the big battle ahead for the U.S. Yeah, you're right on that. Please, speak to that.
Look, this is a key question here, and this is part of the problem we face today. This is one of the basis of bias, discrimination, xenophobia, and racism right now. All of our institutions, governments, faith-based institutions, all of us, my institution, my organization, we've not done enough to explain factually what's happening in the world. We've got four major challenges. First one is demography. We have a global north in demographic deficit. There's a negative replacement rate. More people dying than being born, and those who remain are getting older. And the labor needs are widening. Europe alone is going to need tens of millions of workers at all skill levels by mid-century. Meantime, Africa's population, I've heard various estimates, it could be as much as doubling by mid-century. When I was ambassador to Nigeria, I was told it's a country of 100 million people. Today, I think this number is 160 million or something like that. And it's quite clear, and I think you said it well, we're all going to become, our country is going to become inexorably more multi-ethnic, multi-religious, multilinguistic, in every way. But if we don't have institutions that are doing public education, public information to explain this is about to happen, it's not necessarily bad, and this is our plan. Mm-hmm. And right now, I think one of the problems in Europe is there's a feeling that people have little confidence now in government's ability to manage migration. And I would leave you with the thought that migration is not an issue to be solved. It's a human reality that's been there since the beginning of time. It's not going away, and we have to learn to manage it. And you do that partly through education and information. The other challenge, of course, is learning to manage diversity. We're not doing a good job of that. We need to learn to manage, to prevent disasters like we talked about. And I think if we deal with that, we can solve the problem. But this is the problem. You're right. We've lost control.
Okay. How about...
I just want to ask a question, and maybe it's a product of my background. Is it a problem if the U.S. becomes a majority-minority country? Is it a problem if Europe becomes majority non-white?
It's like becoming like the rest of the world. Becoming like the rest. And that's, in fact, what's going to really change this.
Can I also add that power and privilege at an institution level in the United States, regardless of how many minorities you have, is still very much white? So I don't know what the fear is.
In fact, when Obama talked about in his farewell address, he said progress toward democracy is not assured. Not assured. He said the three factors that can prevent democracy are inequality, racism, and naked partisanship. The three issues he raised moving out of office. Now, I had a microphone over here. Yeah? Two last questions here.
Hi, my name is Irvan, and I'm from Indonesia. Me, myself, I'm also a double minority in my own country, whereas I'm Chinese and I'm also Christian, where the majority of the population is Muslim. My question would be, what are the steps, as Ms. Filali has already mentioned before, what are the steps of this integration, but when there's already so much hatred and animosity between one to another? Because I had to experience firsthand getting away from my own life by being a minority from a genocide in 1998. And it's been a journey of discovering myself, how I am, who I am, as I am Indonesian, but I'm also Chinese. But there are a lot of different things that we already had to go through, and I was just wondering, how can we get this, how can we solve this problem?
Okay, I'm going to take that as the last question, then quickly go down the panel. This issue of belonging, you raised this whole old notion of sort of, from our point of view, the assumption of whiteness, the assumption of white normality, white power. That's the U.S. problem, is the whole idea of being white as normal. That's what's changing dramatically for a new generation. This question of belonging, quickly, belonging and identity, where you asked, what do we do, where do we go? Final words of the panelists, belonging, identity, where do we go? Quick comments.
First problem is that we are trying to preserve or to reinvent societies that never existed. We were never monoethnic, none of us, none of our countries. We all came from somewhere else. And we perpetrated this idea that we're ethnically pure and anybody comes. So it doesn't really matter what the mix is in the end. The real question is what do we have in common? What values do we protect? I think that's the real issue.
Okay. Final comments. Jump in. Sure.
Müssen wir?
Do we have to see categories? Do we have to feel that we belong to any individual category? Is there not a great opportunity in living together in diversity, benefiting from one another's situation? I think this tendency we have to put things in boxes can go too far. I think it's great if we can benefit from each other's strengths and look forward together, living in diversity.
Belonging is the issue. What do we belong to, right? Yeah.
It's very difficult because, in a way, when you really have a strengthened feeling that you belong to a country, to a community, you feel stronger. It's very difficult to be part of a diversity. So maybe if you are very strong in your belonging, you could be able to go ahead and meet somebody else.
I think belonging is a very interesting subject. And the unfortunate truth is that when you're a minority in any context, you have to fight for your belonging. Nobody's going to provide that for you. Mm. And the irony is that in that struggle and in that fight towards equality, you still need the mass influence or the mass power of those who may not be giving you that space on your team. And I think the most powerful thing for any minority community is to, and this is sort of work that we do, is mobilizing the resonant mass. So making your message as mainstream and as palatable as possible. And we do that through content creator challenges. And in fact, in Indonesia, YouTube and Facebook are merging together to create platforms where young Indonesians, particularly from minority communities, increase their exposure, increase their voices, particularly on digital platforms, and to ensure that their messages reach larger and larger young audiences in particular. And so I think it's such a long battle, but I think it's very important that you remember that the biggest challenge and the biggest irony that we face is that you're always going to need the out-group. And you always, always have to let your message be known, because while it's exhaustive to be constantly out there and to tell people I am a human as well and all these other campaigns that are out there, we have more to lose if we don't have that.
Mm-hmm. Maina.
Yeah. I think that's a great question about belonging. And I saw that in Indonesia. I was there in December looking at issues around freedom of assembly and association. But I think all of us have multiple identities. All of us. We're not just white or black. We are people of faith. We are also lawyers. We are women. We are men. We have got all of us have multiple identities. Figuring out which one to use when and what is important when, I think, is an issue that we all have to grapple with and figure out where we are. So I like that idea that we also can have an identity based upon values and a value system that says that defines us, because we've got a value system on where we are in terms of our identities. But I think the other question, the other key issue for all of us to think about, and I think it's how do we talk to those who don't agree with us, and how do we mm-hmm. get the entire world mm-hmm. to accept that you can disagree agreeably is the big challenge. Mm-hmm.
So the issues are political, economic, moral, spiritual, really, but about values. Who are we? What do we want to be? And how do we change our cultures to have those value-based cultures? Could you all give a hand to this extraordinary panel mm-hmm. today? And we want to thank you. Thank you for your time, and go out from here saying, what is the one thing I can do, the one thing I can do right now to make a difference in what we're talking about here today? Thank you for coming.